Hello students, hope you all are well and doing hard work at home. Yesterday we have started with lesson number 10, determination of income and employment, and we have discussed the topics aggregate demand and aggregate supply. Today we will start with the topic aggregate supply, under which we will discuss classical concept of aggregate supply and Keynesian concept of aggregate supply. First of all, let's discuss the key term aggregate supply. Supply of goods like LPG, petrol, diesel, cars, aeroplanes, AC, shampoo, oil, flowers, dresses, shoes, watches, TV sets, jewelry, etc. plus supply of the services like doctors, engineers, share brokers, commission agents, servers, cobblers, teachers, professors, entrepreneurs, etc. When we will sum up of all these, of the supply of all these goods and services, we will get the aggregate supply. So aggregate supply or the domestic final supply is the total supply of goods and services that firms in a national economy plan on selling during a specific time period. It is a total amount of goods and services that a firms are willing and able to sell at a given price level in an economy. So aggregate supply, it is not the actual supply, it is a planned supply. Like the firms have planned that in this year of 2020 we will give the production worth rupees 20,000, but this production can be increased or decreased because it is a planned production. It is not the actual production. It may be the production can be increased to worth rupees 18,000 or 22,000. Then so aggregate supply, it is a planned supply of all the goods and services. Now next one is classical concept of aggregate supply. According to the classical economists, they believe that economy works at a full employment level. Whatever the firms produce, it is consumed by the household sector. There is perfect competition, no interference of the government, no trade unions are there. Whatever production it is there, it is consumed by the household sector. Let's discuss. They are saying that if there are 50 laborers in the economy and all these 50 laborers are working at the prevailing wage rate, at the existing wage rate, and giving the OQ level of output, that is 20 units of output. That's why aggregate supply curve, it is perfectly inelastic, that is vertically parallel to y-axis. Optimum utilization of the labor, it is there according to the classical economist. So according to the classical economist, change in the price level has no effect on the aggregate supply. Whatever the price will be charged, the output remains the same because all the 50 laborers are working at their full capacity and give the OQ level of production, and there is no scope for the further production because no more laborers are there in the economy. So aggregate supply curve is parallel to y-axis, which shows that OQ is the maximum level of output. Classical economist believes that economy is at its full employment, means that if 50 workers are there in the market, all the 50 workers are doing job at the prevailing wage rate, at their full capacity. So 50 laborers are giving maximum output at OQ level. So 20 units of production is the maximum level of production with the 50 laborers. Beyond this point, production cannot be increased because all the services of the laborers are optimally utilized. So the shape of the aggregate supply curve is perfectly inelastic, means output remains the same. Perfectly inelastic means output remains the same at any price level. So classical economists believe that supply creates its own demand, because in our economy there are two sectors, that is household sector and firms. Household sector provides the factors of production to the firms, that is land, labor, capital and entrepreneur, and firms giving factor payments to the household sector for the consumption of goods and services, that is in the form of rent, wages, interest and profit. Rent for land, wages for labor and interest for capital, profit for entrepreneur. Whatever production will be there by the firms, household sector consume it, means aggregate demand, it is equals to aggregate supply. So full employment in the economy. Classical economist believes that no surplus, no deficit in the economy, no interference of the trade union and government. So whatever resources are there, whatever factors of production are there, they all are optimally utilized and the economy, it is at its full employment level. And due to this aggregate supply curve, it is perfectly inelastic parallel to y-axis. Now, according to Keynesian, let's discuss the Keynesian concept of aggregate supply. According to Keynes, aggregate supply, it is perfectly elastic for the short run. He is saying that there is no changes in the price of goods in the short run and the firms can give the production up to any extent till they achieve the point of full employment level. When they reach the full employment level, that is OQ level, it will be their maximum level of output and full employment level prevails in the economy, and at that time aggregate supply shape will be perfectly inelastic. But before that, in the short run, it will be perfectly elastic, that is parallel to x-axis. And when economy reach the level of full employment, aggregate supply curve will be perfectly inelastic. Now next one is, according to Keynes, aggregate supply is perfectly elastic, means at constant price, the output can be increased up to any extent till the point of full employment reached. After reaching the full employment, aggregate supply curve will be perfectly inelastic. See here, before reaching to the point of full employment, price remains the constant. At 10 units of output, price it is rupees 20. At 20 units of output, price rupees 20. At 30 units of output, price rupees 20. But after this, aggregate supply, it is vertical and it is perfectly inelastic by giving maximum level of output, because all the resources, all the factors of production are optimally utilized here. PE and AS shows the full employment level. At point E, aggregate supply is perfectly inelastic with respect to price. In the short run, prices of goods do not change and elasticity of supply can be up to infinity till the point of full employment. Aggregate supply, you know that, depends upon the aggregate demand. So aggregate demand determines the level of income, output and employment. According to Keynes, producer will produce only if they will get the minimum price for their production, so that they can give the wages to the laborers, rent for land, interest for machinery, profit to the entrepreneur. They can give the transport cost also. They can give the electricity bill. They can make the payments for the raw material. Otherwise, he will not produce. At least the producer can cover the cost of production. Here, the producer is covering the cost of production for the variable factors only, not for the fixed factors like machines. Cost of production means the payments to the different factors of production or the variable factors like labor for wages, rent for land, capital for interest and entrepreneur for profit. So Keynes assumed that technology remains the same in short run. So the output can be increased only by the optimal utilization of labor. So sum total of the factor payments, that is rent, wages, interest and profit, that is cost of production, is equal to the wages plus rent plus interest plus profit, and it will give you the net national product at factor cost. Net national product at factor cost, it is nothing but it is a national income. So national income means the money value of all the goods and services that are produced in an economy within a given period of time. So aggregate supply, it is equals to net national product at factor cost, that is equals to national income. A major part of national income is spent on consumption and rest it is saved. So we can say that aggregate supply, it is equals to the Y. Y means income, or it is equals to national income, and it is equals to the summation of two components, that is consumption and saving. So aggregate supply, it is nothing but it is a national income. As we know that consumption can never be zero, even at a zero level of income. So there is a minimum level of consumption for survival, which is independent of the level of income. Saving can be negative. Let's discuss it with the help of a table. In this table, Income level it is denoted by Y and consumption it is denoted by C. Saving it is denoted by S and aggregate supply it is equals to the sum total of two components, that is consumption plus saving. At zero level of income, consumption it is equals to 20 and saving it is equals to minus 20. This consumption it is from our previous savings, that's why it is minus 20, and this is our this saving. And this 20, it is independent of the level of income. This 20 consumption it is independent of the level of income, so it is nothing but it is our autonomous consumption, and this is our this saving. At least this much of money it is required to survive. So when we will sum up these two, 20 minus 20, it will give you 0 aggregate supply. Now next one is, when level of income increase from 0 to 10, consumption also increase from 20 to 25 and saving it is now minus 15. So when we will sum up these two, we will get the aggregate supply 10. 25 minus 15 will give you 10. In the same way, as income level increases, consumption also increases and this saving it is there. This negative sign shows the this savings. But you see that consumption till the level of 30, it is more than income. So we can say that consumption it is more than income. Done. Now next one is, when the income level reaches to 40, consumption also 40. It means that whatever economy has earned, it has spent, it has consumed. So saving it becomes 0 and aggregate supply it is 40. 40 plus 40 consumption plus 0 saving will give you aggregate supply 40. Now next one is, when the income level increase from 40 to 50, consumption it is also increased from 40 to 45 and saving also starts, that is 50 minus 45 rupees 5. After spending 45 rupees, I have saved 5 rupees. So when I will add it, consumption plus saving, I will get aggregate supply 50. Now in the same way, in this segment you can see that level of income, it is more than the level of consumption. So we can write consumption is less than income. And one thing more is here, aggregate supply and income level both are same. Zero level of income, zero aggregate supply. 10 level of income, 10 aggregate supply. So aggregate supply it is nothing but it is the level of income, because aggregate supply of all the goods and services it is measured in the money value. That's why money value will give us the level of income. So aggregate supply is equals to level of income. Let's discuss it on the graph. Income on the x-axis and aggregate supply it is on the y-axis. At zero level of income, consumption it is 20, and this 20 consumption is, you know that it is the autonomous consumption. This is the minimum amount required to survive. So this part 0 to 20, it is known as autonomous consumption. Then now next one is, at 10 level of income, consumption it is 25. At 20 level of income, consumption it is equals to 30. And when I marked all these points and joined these points, I have got this upward sloping straight line from y intercept to upward, that is consumption curve. In the same way, when I marked the points for saving, at zero level of income, saving it is minus 20. Zero level of income, saving minus 20. 10 level of income, savings minus 15. At 20 level of income, savings minus 10. At 30 level of income, savings minus 5. At 40 level of income, savings 0. At 50 levels of income, savings again it is 5. Now when I have joined these points, I have got this supply curve. Supply curve started from the negative part of the negative segment of the y-intercept and crosses the x-axis at 40, where saving it is equals to 0 and it is upward sloping straight line. Now next one is, mark the point for aggregate supply. At zero level of income, aggregate supply is 10. Aggregate supply is 0. एंड एट 10 लेवल ऑफ इनकम एग्रीगेट सप्लाई इट इज 10, एट 20 लेवल ऑफ इनकम एग्रीगेट सप्लाई इट इज 20, एट 30 लेवल ऑफ इनकम एग्रीगेट सप्लाई इट इज 30. सो व्हेन आई हैव जॉइंड दीज पॉइंट्स आई हैव गॉट दिस वन सप्लाई कर्व, अपवर्ड स्लोपिंग सप्लाई कर्व फ्रॉम ओरिजिन टू अपवर्ड, एंड इट क्रॉसिस द इंटरसेक्ट द कंजम्पशन कर्व एट पॉइंट ई वेयर सेविंग्स आर ऑल्सो जीरो, कंजम्पशन एंड एग्रीगेट सप्लाई बोथ आर सेम, कंजम्पशन एंड इनकम और एग्रीगेट सप्लाई बोथ आर सेम, सेविंग इट इज जीरो. सो दिस इज द इक्विलिब्रियम पॉइंट, दिस इज योर ऑटोनोमस कंजम्पशन. नाउ नेक्स्ट वन इज दिस पार्ट शोज द डिस सेविंग, दिस पार्ट लोअर सेगमेंट ऑन द वाई इंटरसेप्ट शोज द डिस सेविंग. देन नाउ वी कैन से दैट एग्रीगेट सप्लाई इज द मनी वैल्यू ऑफ ऑल द गुड्स एंड सर्विसेज प्रोड्यूस्ड इन अ कंट्री इन अ ईयर्स टाइम, दैट इज नेशनल इनकम, और द सम ऑफ कंजम्पशन एंड सेविंग विल गिव यू द एग्रीगेट इनकम, एंड द मिनिमम प्राइस विच द एंटरप्रेन्योर्स शुड रिसीव फ्रॉम द सेल ऑफ द आउटपुट एट गिवन लेवल ऑफ एम्प्लॉयमेंट सो दैट दे कैन गिव द पेमेंट फॉर वेजेस, इंटरेस्ट, रेंट, प्रॉफिट, ट्रांसपोर्ट कॉस्ट, इलेक्ट्रिसिटी बिल, पेमेंट फॉर द रॉ मटेरियल. सो थैंक यू फॉर लिसनिंग स्टूडेंट्स, होप यू ऑल हैव अंडरस्टूड. नोट डाउन द होमवर्क प्लीज, डिस्कस द क्लासिकल कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ एग्रीगेट सप्लाई एंड केन्जियन कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ एग्रीगेट सप्लाई, एंड प्लीज गो थ्रू द यूट्यूब लिंक्स फॉर मोर क्लियरिटी. थैंक यू फॉर लिसनिंग.